class. Today we're going to start our chapter on factoring. And in this chapter, your book actually has everything separated into different sections with one type of thing that you're looking at in each section. I'm going to actually simplify this into a two-question process where these two questions will guide you through any problem, no matter where it is in the entire chapter. And in this video, we're going to concentrate on the first question. The first thing that you want to ask yourself when you're factoring something, no matter what the problem is whether there is a common factor or not. So we're going to take a look at this first question right here, is there a common factor? Now, when we take a look at that question, that common factor actually has a special name. We call it the greatest common factor. And the greatest common factor is often referred to as a GCF. Now, that greatest common factor is going to be the largest thing that divides evenly into everything in your particular polynomial that you're looking at. When we're talking about factoring, we're actually talking about reversing our multiplication. So in the last chapter, we might have been asked to multiply something like 2x plus 3 times x minus 5. And when we multiplied this, we would have FOIL'd it out, and you would have taken 2x times x, which would have been 2x squared, and then 2x times negative 5, which is negative 10x, and then 3 times x, which is 3x, and then finally 3 times negative 5, which is negative 15. And then you would have simplified, and you would have had 2x squared minus 7x minus 15. And in the last chapter, this would have been your answer. In this chapter, this here is going to be the problem, and your goal is going to be to tell me what was this that was multiplied. So we're going to be going backwards with all of our multiplying. Now, what we saw right here, going from here all the way back to there, is actually something that we're going to learn in a later video. The first question of is there a common factor is actually going to be reversing our distributive property. Now let's take a look at a problem from last chapter that we might have multiplied that reversed our, or that asked us to distribute so that we can reverse it and go backwards. So for instance, in the last chapter, you might have multiplied 10 times x squared times 2x cubed minus 5x plus 4. And when you distributed, you took 10x squared times the 2x cubed and got 20x to the fifth. Then 10x squared times negative 5x was negative 50x cubed, and then 10x squared times the 4 was a 40x squared. Now in the last chapter, this was our answer. In this chapter, you're going to be given this and have to get back up here to this. So we're going to pretend that we didn't actually know any of this. It did not exist. And we're asked to factor out the GCF. Now the GCF is the greatest common factor, so even though we might have smaller numbers that divide into all of these, we want to look for the largest. Now to factor out the greatest common factor, since we're going to reverse our distributive property, we want to look at each of these terms and see what they have in common. Now, we want something that divides evenly into all of these, and specifically, we want the largest thing that divides evenly into all of these. It helps to break this down and do the numbers first and then go to the letters. So we're going to start with just the 20, the 50, and the 40. And if you look at all of those, the largest thing that divides evenly into them is 10. So since we're reversing our distributive property, we're going to write the 10 out front and then stick our parentheses in there that would have been there for our distributive property if we were going to be asked to distribute. Then we're going to take and say, okay, if I'm multiplying this 10 into here, The reverse would be to divide 10 into each of these to figure out what was in here. So once you get the 10 out front, what you want to do is divide it into each of these values to figure out what's left in your parentheses. So 20 divided by 10 gives you 2. And then 50 divided by the 10, and since it's negative 50 because it's a minus 50 divided by the 10, we're going to put a minus 5. And then 40 divided by the 10 is 4, and it's positive, so we put a plus. Notice that I left spaces here, 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 and here. That's because now I'm going to go back and do my letters. And since I'm going to go back and do my letters, I need some space here for them. So let's look at these variables. Every single term has an x. If even one of the terms was missing the x, we would not be able to factor an x out. But since every term has an x, we can factor it out. Now keep in mind that when you distribute the x into the parentheses, you're multiplying, and when you multiply, you add exponents. So if we're reversing that, we're going to be subtracting exponents because we're going to be dividing in order to figure out what's left in here when we factor out an x out here. Now, you can't subtract more than what you have, so what you do to figure out what power you need on your x is you look at all of these exponents, and whichever one's the lowest one is the one that's going to go on your x out front here. And the lowest one is x squared. So we're going to put an x squared out here with our 10. And then to figure out what should be left in each of these, we're going to divide x squared into each of these. And when you divide, you subtract exponents. So 5 minus the 2 leaves me with an x cubed. And then 3 minus the 2 leaves me with an x to the first, which we just write as x. And then when you do x squared divided by x squared, you're left with no x's, so we leave this blank because we don't normally put an x to the 0 in our expression. If you were told to factor out the GCF, this entire thing here would be your answer. If you were asked what is the GCF, you would say that the GCF is 10x squared. The GCF is what you factored out in front of your parentheses, and the factored form of your expression is the entire thing with the GCF out front and your parentheses following it. So that is what the greatest common factor is. Let's do one more, and then we'll look at one that's a little bit tricky. This next one is going to be 34x cubed y squared minus 51x squared y plus 17x. Now, if you take a look at these, let's look at the numbers first. We have a 34, a 51, and a 17, and I notice 17 is prime. So I'm going to check and see if 17 divides into each of these two. If it does, then that's going to be our GCF for the numbers only. And it does. It goes into 34 twice and 51 three times. So I'm going to use 17 as the value that I factor out for my numbers. So I'm going to put a 17 here, and then I'm going to make my parentheses, leaving space for the x's and the y's. To figure out what's remaining inside here for each of the three terms, I'm going to divide this 17 into each of these numbers. And 17 into 34 is 2. And then 17 into negative 51 is a negative 3, so I'm going to put a minus 3. And then 17 into 17 is 1, and it's a positive 1, so I'm going to put plus 1. And even if it is 1, you do need to put the 1 there. That kind of holds the place value, and what you can think of as a place value, and shows you that there is that third term on the end. Whereas if you did not have that, you may end up in your final answer only having two terms, when in reality this first item, or original polynomial, had three terms. So now we're done with the numbers. Let's take a look at the variables. Notice that all three of them have an x. And the lowest exponent is a 1, which is what's on this last term. So I'm going to just factor out an x, and I'm going to do the x's in red. I did the numbers in blue so you can see them kind of color-coded. Remember, this has a 1. If you need to write it in there while you're showing your work, that's fine just to remind yourself at first, but try to wean yourself off of needing it. So now this 1x here divided into the x cubed, we subtract the exponents, 3 minus the 1 is 2, so this leaves you with an x squared right here. And now 2 minus the 1 is 1, so that leaves you with an x to the first. And then when you divide x into the x out here, there aren't any left, so notice all we're left for this last term is just a 1. Now let's look at the y's. Notice that only the first two terms have a y. The last one does not. That means that it is not in common with all of them. Since it's not in common with all of them, we need to just carry it down and leave it in each of those first two terms. If you were asked to just factor out the GCF, your solution would be this expression, the entire thing with the 17x in front, and then the parentheses and all of this inside. If you were asked what is the GCF, you would say that the GCF is 17x. Now, let's take a look at one where the GCF is just a little bit harder to see what it is. It's kind of there in disguise. You have to be careful to watch for it. You might have something like 5 times 2x minus 3 plus x times 2x minus 3. When you're looking at this, you might have an inclination to want to go ahead and distribute the 5 and distribute the x. However, we don't really want to do that. What we want to do is treat this entire thing as if it's one gigantic term. And this thing over here is if it's one gigantic term. The 5 being multiplied by this 2x minus 3 and the x being multiplied by this 2x minus 3 means that one of the things that we can look at as if they were a variable would be the 2x minus 3. For instance, if we just kind of replace that 2x minus 3 hypothetically with a y, what if our problem, instead of being what it is, was 5y plus xy? If you looked at this more simplified form, you'd say, well, they both have a y in common. So you would factor that y out and be left with 5 plus x. We're going to do that same thing with this expression up here, except for our y is really not a y. Our y is this entire parentheses, 2x minus 3. Both this term and that term have a 2x minus 3. So what we're going to do is factor out the 2x minus 3, and if you factor it out of this first term here, you're left with the 5, and if you factor out of the second term, you're left with this x here. And this is what you get when you factor out that GCF that is actually that entire parentheses of 2x minus 3. So watch for a common parentheses. That's just like having a common variable. Let's go ahead and take a look at one more of those, and then I'll show you how if you have 4 terms, you can kind of do a little grouping process that will create these parentheses for you. So let's say, what if we had 3x times x minus 5 minus 2 times x minus 5. What you want to do is pretend that this is one really big term and this is one really big term. Notice they both have an x minus 5 involved, that entire parenthesis. So what we're going to do is factor out that x minus 5, and that's going to leave us with, in the first term, just that 3x, and in the second term here, just the minus 2. And this here would be your answer, and the GCF is this, what you see in red here, which is the x minus 5. Now, there's one tricky situation that you want to be really careful about. What if we had 5x times x plus 3 plus, in parentheses, x plus 3? It looks like this is one big term, and then this is just a parentheses. But keep in mind that in front of anything, there's always that invisible one. This particular problem where there's a plus right here and nothing after it in front of the parentheses will be much easier to deal with if you insert a 1, because you can multiply 1 by anything and not change its value. So inserting that 1 makes you realize that when we factor out the common x plus 3 here and here, that you're going to be left with a 5x here and a 1 here. So we end up with an x plus 3 as the GCF from the two terms, and a 5x is left in this first spot, and a 1 is left right here. And if you multiply it out, you can see that this was the way it is. Now, these problems here are prepping us for what do you do if you have four terms in a problem and you need to factor it. So we're going to use this process here to take a look at those real quick. And we're going to deal with a problem that might look like x cubed plus 3x squared plus 2x plus 3. Now, actually, excuse me, not plus 3, we're going to do plus 6. There we go. Okay, now what we're going to do here is whenever there's four terms, we're going to try and create those common parentheses we just saw in the last two problems. So what we're going to do is take and put parentheses around the first two and the last two. And then you're going to treat this as if it's one problem where you're asking this, is there a common factor question? And in this problem here, they both have x's, and the lowest exponent is x squared. So we're going to factor out an x squared. When you do that, this 3 minus the 2 leaves you with an x in the first term, and then the x squared's completely factored out of the second term, so we just have a 3. If we go to the second parentheses and do the same thing, over here notice they both have a 2 in common. So we're going to factor out a 2, and once we factor out a 2, 2 divides into 2x, leaving just x, and 2 divided into 6 is 3. Notice that what's happened is both terms have an x plus 3. So we have a really large term here and a really large term here, and they both have that parentheses in common. If that parentheses does not match and you have actually factored out the greatest common factor, then you will know that you can't factor the problem any further and that it was prime, which means the only factor is 1 in itself. So now that we have created parentheses that are in common, we're going to factor that parentheses out, which is the x plus 3, and what will be left is the x squared plus 2. And that will be your answer after factoring that four-term item. We're going to be doing more of these as we get into factoring three terms in a later video.